student was matched with an insufferable roommate. This is how his organs were shut down. AC is a 24-year-old man presenting to the emergency room with abdominal pain, nausea, and diffuse bleeding. By the time the ambulance showed up, AC was only dry heaving because there was nothing else left to come up. AC was a graduate student. He lived in the dorms. His roommate, Jason, had the awful habit of slamming doors shut, and he'd stomp around everywhere like weights were tied to his feet. This noise got on everyone's nerves. Jason was disliked by everyone, and he had no self-awareness. AC nicely asked Jason if he could maybe quietly close the doors, because slamming was loud, kind of obnoxious. He told Jason that the sound would shake his soul out of his body. But as the weeks passed, it didn't seem like asking politely was going to work. One evening, AC went to bed early and Jason came home late. He saw AC sleeping and slammed the door extra hard. "That's what you get for trying to tell me what to do," he thought. This woke AC up. Enraged, he yelled back, but Jason just couldn't be bothered, and the hostility started to boil. AC would scream at video games, especially on the nights before Jason had important exams, just to get back at him. The screaming wasn't very long. They were short and loud bursts of emotion, just enough to wake Jason up, but not enough for him to know that his roommate was screwing with him. And every time this happened, Jason would fail the exam because he didn't sleep well the night before. In his mind, AC was a meddling, insufferable roommate trying to control his life, and it was time to do anything to get rid of him. Months into the semester, AC thought that brushing his teeth felt kind of weird. One morning, he thought the toothbrush smelled really bad. It made him feel ill. Everything about the experience was horrible, and he didn't know why. But a few days later, AC walked into the bathroom, and he saw Jason kneeling at the toilet like he was cleaning it. AC saw Jason scrubbing the toilet with his toothbrush. Suddenly, it made sense to him why brushing his teeth the last few days was so awful. When he confronted Jason, there was no explanation other than the toilet was dirty. It really needed to be cleaned, and the toothbrush was the only thing laying around. I swear to God, I thought it was mine. This kind of blatant malice transcended the boundaries of typical disrespect that Jason normally showed, but Jason still wasn't finished. One day, both students were cramming for upcoming exams. AC opened his water bottle. He wasn't sure if he smelled something, and he thought that this was a brand new bottle. It should have been sealed, but it wasn't. He didn't remember opening it earlier, but maybe he did and forgot. When he examined closer, it seemed like everything was okay. He took a sip. It didn't really taste different than before, so probably nothing, he thought. But something terrible was about to happen. As the hours passed, AC felt the room was getting warm. He was sweating, thinking of cooling down. He took more sips out of the bottle, but he just couldn't really put his finger on what was wrong. It tasted fine, it looked fine, but something about it just wasn't fine. He wasn't sure if there was a smell or not, but the room was just so hot and the water was refreshing. AC took a nap at his desk, but when he woke up, he felt a dull, hollowing sensation emanate from his stomach. He felt like he was in a sweltering room, boiling up. He thought maybe he could try changing the position of his body, that standing up would help a little bit to get blood flowing around, but then he started to get lightheaded, and it felt like his guts were getting dragged into the ground as he was brought down to the chair. AC could feel blood rush into his head as his vision became dark. He was in a world of hurt, and he didn't know why. Jason turned around and asked, "Oh no, what's wrong? Are you okay?" When AC asked if Jason thought it felt hot in the room, Jason said, "Oh no, not at all. Maybe you're just playing too many games on that laptop and it's firing you up." But then AC started dry heaving. "You okay, man? Maybe you want to get that checked out? Oh no. Do you need me to call a doctor for you?" Jason said. AC tried to go to bed that night, but at 3 a.m., he was in the bathroom in a world of hurt. He felt like his insides were getting scooped out like ice cream. And with every dry heave, his eyes would squeeze a little bit more out of his skull. And when nothing more could come up, AC collapsed to the floor, an ambulance was called, and he's brought to the emergency room where we are now. At examination, the medical team notes that AC is in distress and he has severe abdominal pain that radiated to his back. Aside from intense pain and nausea, that's everything that was wrong, except a blood test finds that something might be happening to his liver. The lab numbers were just a little off, so maybe nothing serious, at least not yet. As time passes in the hospital, AC has 20-minute periods where he'd seem okay, nothing was wrong, but this would be followed by a massive surge in pain, and every time this happened, the periods where he'd feel better started to get shorter. 2 days earlier, AC was at the same hospital. He thought maybe he had food poisoning, but he also told the doctors about his roommate brushing the toilet with his toothbrush. At the time, doctors gave him IV fluids and he seemed to feel better. They told him to come back if he still felt sick, and now that he's here again with similar symptoms, they thought that this was just a continuation of the same illness, but AC started to get confused in the hospital bed. Another blood test shows that whatever was happening to his liver earlier was very quickly getting worse. Parts of his liver have died and are now floating around in his blood. These lab values were right at the upper limit of normal the first time, but a couple hours later, now, they're 20 times higher. This massive, sudden increase indicates that something terrible is happening, but what could it be? This is both easy and difficult to pinpoint. AC's 24. He didn't have any known health problems. At this age, sudden onset liver failure doesn't happen out of nowhere. Doctors had tested AC for viral infections like hepatitis. Those can destroy the liver, but he didn't have any of those. That means then it's likely he consumed something that caused this. That's the easy part. The hard part is figuring out what exactly did he consume. Using a toothbrush that cleaned the toilet is gross, but it's not something that'll cause a life-threatening illness. The doctors did note a possibly hostile roommate in his record, but no one else thought anything more of this. As the hours pass, AC starts to become somnolent. Another blood test finds that he has hyperammonemia. Hyper meaning high. Ammon referring to ammonia, a result of protein metabolism in the body, and emia meaning presence in blood. High ammonia presence in blood because his liver can no longer process proteins. Ammonia is a neurotoxin. It impairs the brain's electricity. It brings other chemicals into the brain. AC's liver failure is shutting down his brain now, but this wasn't the only thing happening to him. While he could still talk, he suddenly told doctors that he could taste something metallic in his mouth that got more and more intense. His gums were bleeding. When doctors looked at him, they noticed that the whites of his eyes were red. His eyes were bleeding. Normally, we have proteins that will make blood clots, stopping bleeding, but these proteins are made in the liver, something that doesn't function inside AC because large parts of it are dying, so he doesn't have these proteins anymore. A couple days after AC had presented to the emergency room and before he fell unconscious, doctors stuck a needle into his abdomen to take a sample of his liver to look at under a microscope. The images showed that very specific areas of his liver had died. The pattern that emerged suggested that maybe a specific kind of toxic chemical that deliberately destroys DNA somehow got into AC's body, maybe intentionally put there by something or someone. And knowing that AC was having a bad time with his roommate, someone who knew intimate details of his living arrangement, the doctors got on the phone with the police. Maybe this was a mistake, maybe this was an accident, but someone needs to look deeper. The authorities quickly got involved. AC was a medical student doing his coursework, so he didn't have access to any laboratories, but Jason was employed as a research assistant in a lab, one that does experiments on tumors. Chemicals in labs like this have the ability to cause the kind of specific illness and permanent organ damage that AC was experiencing. Authorities had a suspicion that Jason might have an idea of what was going on, but Jason was at the hospital. He walked right in without anyone noticing, and he got into AC's room. "Hey buddy, how's it going? How you feeling?" "Oh, you can't talk. That's okay. I brought you a gift," he said. But AC was unconscious. The pupils will constrict so as to limit the amount of light coming in. This reflex is normal, and it should happen when the brain is intact, but when doctors shine a light into AC's eyes, his pupils don't respond. His brain might not be intact anymore. It's possible the bleeding in his gums and his eyes might now be happening in his brain. Earlier in his admission, doctors sent a needle into his spine to draw some fluid that cushions and protects the brain out. Looking at it would give doctors some clues as to what's happening. That fluid isn't supposed to have blood in it, but when they look, blood was everywhere, indicating that his brain was bleeding. A CT scan finds a giant mass of blood swelling into his brain. All of this happening because his liver has completely shut down in his body, but something's wrong. Right next to the liver are so many other organs. None of them seem to be affected directly. If anything is wrong with them, it's because his liver is dying, not because the toxin is acting on them. But what kind of toxin does this? Police obtained authority to enter AC and Jason's dorm room to see if they could find things. Before he became incapacitated, AC had mentioned to doctors that he thought something was wrong with his water bottle. It was still on his desk. In the lab, they tested the water bottle and they found what appeared to be the chemical N-nitroso-dimethylamine, NDMA. And this explains to them what was happening to AC. The The liver breaks down chemicals that aren't supposed to be in your body, neutralizing them. This protects your body. A lot of chemicals are reactive. Another way of saying that is that the chemical is unstable, and it'll react with substances and structures in the body by either shoving parts of itself onto those substances and structures, breaking them, or by taking parts from those substances and structures, destroying them. Reactive chemicals need to be neutralized quickly before they can do damage, and the liver has all the necessary tools to handle this, except NDMA is different. When the liver breaks it down, the result is something that's even more reactive. It gets into the cells and inserts itself into DNA. There's two scenarios here. First, in small amounts, enough DNA is changed that when that cell reproduces, those changes persist into subsequent generations. Over time, these changes can continue to evolve, and if enough cells acquire certain changes, a tumor can start to develop. But in very large amounts, the cells just die, fitting the pattern that was happening to AC's liver, but there's more. When doctors look at the images from the microscope, they noticed a pattern where the cells around the vein taking blood out of his liver were all dead. This explains why his liver shut down so quick. It explains why it stopped making blood clot proteins causing diffuse bleeding, and why it couldn't process proteins anymore, causing ammonia to spill into his blood, shutting down his brain. But how did NDMA get into AC's water bottle? When authorities checked the room, they found a vial on Jason's desk. Knowing that he did research on tumors, and knowing that NDMA causes tumors, they checked this vial, and in it was NDMA. This isn't a common household chemical. Regular people aren't going to have this sitting around in their dorm rooms, and it doesn't just magically find itself in someone's water bottle. The police contacted Jason's laboratory and found receipts showing that they did purchase NDMA for their experiments, and this is where they figured out exactly what happened. Jason smuggled NDMA out of his lab. He wanted to get back at AC for telling him what to do, for waking him up and causing him to fail his tests. Brushing the toilet with AC's toothbrush wasn't enough. He knew NDMA would cause damage to AC because in his research, he used it to induce tumors. He knew what it would do to AC, but growing a tumor takes a long time. By then, they wouldn't be roommates anymore, and no one would know because NDMA is entirely undetectable in the blood after a few days, but it hangs around in the liver continuously causing damage, even in small amounts. He thought that this was going to be something easy, but he emptied the entire vial into AC's water bottle. NDMA mixes in water, and so it was hard to tell that anything was wrong. In the hospital, doctors were monitoring AC's brain activity. It was becoming low. His heart rate was slowing down. Even if doctors found NDMA earlier, the moment that AC took his first sip of the water, it was done. There's no known antidote for this, and even in medical literature, there's only a handful of descriptions of poisonings in this amount, and the tumor-causing ability of this chemical has been well documented for decades. Something that you might find in literature if you search N-nitrosodimethylamine, and I don't want you to be scared about this, is that it appears in cured meats, including bacon and ham. That's why some meat packages will say that they don't contain nitrates and nitrites, because foods that have those will form nitrosamines when cooked. And that's why you'll see reports saying things like bacon causes cancer. But if you notice, the levels that are reported in bacon are parts per billion, so they're really low. That's not to say that there's no risk, just be aware of this. And know that AC was given a massive direct dose, equivalent to if he ate more than a billion pieces of bacon's worth of NDMA. As the days passed, AC's brain activity on the monitor was gone. His heart rate was zero. At autopsy, they found that fluid had swelled into his brain and bleeding was all over the right side. Every organ in his body showed signs of hemorrhage. His liver had a nutmeg appearance, meaning that blood flow was congested and that many parts of it had been starving of oxygen for a long time before it was over. And they were able to confirm that this was from a massive N-nitrosodimethylamine poisoning. Authorities gathered enough evidence. Jason was arrested. He was put on trial. He was found guilty of all charges, and he was sentenced. A lot of us have had roommates that we probably really didn't like. I was pretty lucky that I've always had very good ones, but I remember seeing others on my floor have problems in their rooms and in their clusters. If you have unreconcilable differences with your roommates, you can only control your own actions, and the best way is trying to find any way possible to physically move yourself out of that situation, not to do anything to them. Needless to say, permanently remove them, like what happened here. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.